Hey everyone, good morning, good evening to the intellectual world of LinkedIn. Today I'm going to talk about democracy. Today I'm going to talk about India and its constitution. Whenever I get some time, I read about Constitution of India. Now, why I read about Constitution of India? After so many years, I became a lawyer. I think I cleared law in 2010. I sat for the bar exam in the year 2010. So it's been a decade of experience in the law field, and I feel very privileged and feel very good about the thought process that I'm one person who is not only into the corporate affairs of international policy making, but I do litigations before the Indian courts as well, and understanding the sentiments of how the stakeholders, because in the courtroom the stakeholders are the judges, the prosecutors, the lawyers who are involved in solving that issue at hand. Coming back to the point here is, let's just talk about Constitution of India. For me, if there was not ifs and buts in my life, I was supposed to be a medical doctor, because I hail from a family of doctors where we have more than 13 medical doctors in my first bloodline itself. Stating the fact, my forefathers were barristers from Calcutta, and a part of me was always the barrister gene in me was very much activated since my childhood. Stating the fact, I was a very keen reader as far as social sciences was concerned, and I had scored 85 marks in my social sciences. So I did my the board was CBSE. So it's been ages now. That's again 18 years. I sat for 10th standard exam in the year 2000 and senior secondary exam in the year 2002. So when I sat for the exam, I had scored 85 in my social studies, and I was expecting somewhere between 97-98, because I think I know my subject very well, and when I'm very conversant with what I read, write, I really want to score well. However, that was the highest marks which anybody got that year, and in the same year we had someone in our class, in our batch itself, who had scored 100 on 100 in mathematics. And coming from a convent school, our father had congratulated the mathematician, and I was expecting that, you know, even social studies is a very important subject as far as understanding the policy making is concerned. So I knew that a part of me was always a lawyer, and even though I started my career as a food technologist, then I hopped as a biotechnologist, then I cleared the patent agent exam, which was very near and dear to me at that point of time. So Constitution has been a question which has been asked in all the vivas of law exam practical. Stating the fact, whenever I resonate with United Nations, the SDG goal with which I have been working is goal number 17. However, I'll just walk you through the understanding of the sustainable development goals. These are the blueprints to achieve a better and a more sustainable future for all. So all means that 8 billion people who are living on this planet Earth, accounted or unaccounted number, because there are many tribals, there are many people who are cut off from the online world, and they don't want to communicate, and they live in tribes in forests across the world. They address, now they here is the sustainable development goals address the global challenges humans are facing, including so many things. But what I believe is the solution to everything is goal number 17. And goal number 17 is all to do with partnerships. And if we, I'm just going through the goals, because I'll just see the goal number 17 is to, which is to lobby with government to boost development financing, because that's the need of the hour also, how we deploy revival packages to achieve the SDGs, to open up USD 12 trillion of market opportunities, and create, the hypothesis is to create 380 million new jobs by 2030. So when we talk about new skill sets, so new jobs is all to do or understand the new skill sets, which is the need of the hour. And India being world's largest democracy right now, where judiciary is the third pillar of democracy, I think judiciary is changing for good. In judiciary, everything is being connected for the very first time. And I believe if the parties agree to the thought process, just like in IPR, we have video conferencing. I think at least the judicial proceedings should be available to public at large, because then public at large will appreciate the fact how the judiciary is working, because judiciary being the third pillar of democracy should not be kept aside from other aspects. Coming back to the point of Constitution of India, I'll read a few of the liners and discuss when I think those pointers needs to be discussed. Constitution in India has been the theme noticeable also an acknowledged federation. So different federations across the globe has acknowledged the Constitution of India. For example, in USA, that is United States of America, Canada and Australia. So these, if we consider right now, the Trinity is USA, Canada and Australia. So these main three places have, these federations have acknowledged the Indian Constitution in a big way. This shift towards centralization is indicative of the transformation in the traditional concept of federation. Right now, when we are deploying Industry 4 era for real in the online world, which was ought to happen few years from now, which is being, I would say, it's kind of a speedy justice right now, or it is being deployed in a speedy manner right now. So it's a transformational period. How this transformational period can be understood by more people, and I believe there are many courses which are coming as elective courses for people who are into sciences to take up and understand IPR. I think intellectual property rights or the basic or the basis has to be ingrained right from standard fifth. I think when a kid turns 9 years, I don't know what's the minimum age of students to join nursery, because in our time it was less, and I'm fortunate enough that I was double promoted. Again, that was an experimental stage which was happening in army school. So coming back to the point here is the Indian Constitution adopts the following means to mitigate the rigors of rigidity and legalism. It provides a long list of co-current subjects. The Indian Constitution has, like the Australian Constitution, made a number of provisions which are to remain in force until Parliament by law provides otherwise. What happens in emergencies? This is a time of emergency right now, not only in India but globally. So in emergencies, the Constitution can become unitary. Again, I'll repeat, in the time of emergency, the Constitution becomes unitary, and this has been explained in point number 4 of distinctive federation in the Constitution of India. And I think the lawmakers in India should look into this pointer of distinctive federation. Point number 4, in normal times, the Constitution is framed to work as a federal system, but in times of war and other national emergencies, it is designed to work as if it were unitary. So when I say united we stand, so basically unitary means you have to be united. All the parties who are the stakeholders right now representing the people of India have to work in a united fashion. In the Constituent Assembly, Dr. Ambedkar explained all federal systems, including the American, are placed in the tight mold of federalism. No matter what the circumstances, it cannot change its form and shape. It cannot be unitary. On the other hand, draft constitution can both be unitary as well as federal according to the requirement of time and circumstance. And today, the time and circumstance is all about United We Stand. So it maintains unity in basic matters. So when we talk about distinctive federation, it maintains unity in basic matters. A federation being a dual polity based on divided authority with separate legislative, executive and judicial powers for each of the two polities, it is bound to produce diversity in law. So the need of the hour, what I believe is uniformity in fundamental laws, civil and criminal, and what needs to be added right now is intellectual property law. Thank you.